All right, we are in the book of Revelation in chapter 2. Let's go through and read a little bit of this. We're going to read down to verse 11 this morning. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. I'm going to read out loud. You guys can follow along with me. Why don't y'all stand while we do it? In verse 1, it says, "To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. And you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things says the first and the last who was dead and came to life. I know your works, your tribulation and poverty, but you are rich. And I know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death." We'll stop right there and let's pray. And Father, as we're again getting into your word, Lord, we thank you for the fact that you speak through it. You speak to us through the Bible, and you tell us things that we need to hear. And like this passage says, you tell us that we need to open up our ears. He who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. And so, Father, as we're going through and looking at these things that you've said to these specific churches, we just pray that you'd help us to have ears that are open to your voice and that you just work in us. And we ask that you do this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You have a seat. You know, I'm not going to go over all the stuff that I've been talking about for the last couple of weeks, but we're going through a series of letters that Jesus wrote to seven churches in Asia Minor, which is Turkey nowadays. That's what we would call Asia Minor, is Turkey. And these churches in Asia Minor, there were seven literal churches. And so when you go through and you look at these passages, these were things that were taking place in about 95 AD. That's when the book of Revelation was written. And so there are issues in each one of these churches. And one of the cool things about going through Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3 is it's literally a quote from Jesus. So you can see what Jesus thinks of church. And this is one of those things that I pointed out last time in our study. You know, there's all kinds of things that people think about church. There's things that church people think about church and how church should be run. There are things that I think about church and how church should be run. There are things that the world thinks about church and how church should be run. But what we've got here is a message that's straight from Jesus. And we get to know what Jesus thinks about church and how church should be run. And one of the things that you have here is that Jesus doesn't whitewash the church. He doesn't sit there and think that everything's hunky-dory, fine and dandy. If there are problems, he points out the problems and he lets people know what's up. We're only going to be doing these first two churches. Actually, I'm finishing up the church at Ephesus here this morning, and we're going to get into the church at Smyrna. But as you go through and you look at these churches, you see all kinds of issues. Some of the issues have to do with idolatry, literally in the church. Some of the issues have to do with hypocrisy, where people are faking, you know, pretending to be something that they're not. And what Jesus does is he just calls it all out. He calls it all out. He sees everything. He sees everything. And we need to understand that he does that. When people are pretending to be something, you know what? You can, Abraham Lincoln is quoted as saying, you can fool some of the people some of the time. Or excuse me, you can fool some of the people all the time. You can fool all the people some of the time. But you can't fool all of the people all of the time. That's what Lincoln said. You know what it is with Jesus? You can't fool him any of the time, ever. And so he knows exactly what's going on, and he knows when we're pretending to be something that we're not. And so, again, what you're going to see is Jesus going through and just calling people out. And obviously, in some of the situations, he calls them out kindly, and that's what he's doing to the church at Ephesus. And as we go through and look at some of the other churches, it gets a little bit more intense when the issues are a little bit more intense. And so you can expect the Lord to just be like that. In the first church, we have the church at Ephesus, and we talked last week about Ephesus in the book of Acts. It was one of those churches that was really famous. In fact, the book of Ephesians is written to the church at Ephesus along with this letter. And these guys were known, again, for, if you look in verse 2, Jesus says, "I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you've tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars, and you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary." And I went through last week and went into that extensively. They have work, they have labor, they have perseverance. Perseverance just means stick-to-itiveness. You hang in there with Jesus all the way to the end, is the idea. And I'm not going to go over it again. If you weren't here last week, that would be worth listening to, because a lot of times what people do is they pass over those passages, and Jesus doesn't do that. He knows your labor. He knows your work. He knows the fact that you are hanging in there with him. He sees all of that stuff. And so there's not a situation where we are laboring for the Lord and he's not understanding that and he's not appreciative of that. He sees it all. Whether anybody else is seeing the things that you're doing for the Lord, whether anybody else is acknowledging the things that you're doing for the Lord, Jesus is seeing those things. He sees it all. There's a great passage in Matthew chapter 10 that I always refer to, and there's a point to it. And the point is this. Jesus said, if you give somebody a cup of cold water in my name, you're going to receive a reward for it. He sees even the smallest things that you do for him. He hears the conversations that you have about him, according to the book of Malachi. And so he knows everything that's going on. And he doesn't look at that and just pass over it. Again, he says twice to these guys, talks twice about their patience, that you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. But then in verse 4, he says, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Now, one of the things that we have in the letters to the churches is this structure. And the structure goes like this. There's a greeting or an address, basically an introduction. And then there's a description of Jesus or a title of Christ. There's a commendation, and we just read the commendation. Then there's a condemnation, where Jesus talks about the problems. Then there's an exhortation where Jesus talks about how to fix the problems. And then there's a call to hear. And in each one of these letters, Jesus says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And then finally, there's a promise to the overcomer. And so Jesus has commended these guys, and now he's going to talk to them about what the problems are. Do you like hearing about the problems that you have in your life? Do you like that? I don't know anybody who likes that. I don't know anybody, especially when it's coming from the Lord. I don't know anybody who likes to hear about the problems that they've got going on in their life. But you know what? God is faithful, and he will speak to you about those whole things. And it's not because he's trying to trash you or trying to condemn you. The reason that he's doing that is because he's trying to make you more like him. The Bible talks about the fact that somebody who's not open to correction is a fool. He's a fool. And so we as believers need to be obviously open to correction. And the cool thing, again, about Jesus is that he always knows what needs to be corrected, right? And so he's going to tell you the absolute truth about those things. When Jesus talks about these guys, he commends them for all their work and the fact that these guys are discerning. They know the difference between truth and a lie. They know when somebody is trying to pretend to be something that they're not. In this case, those who say they are apostles and are not, and you have found them liars. And so you have people who are sticking in there with Jesus, and they are discerning. And that's all good stuff. But the problem that Jesus has with them is that they don't love him anymore. That's the problem. And he says in verse 5, verse 4, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. And one of the things that we need to remember as believers is that basically when we're talking about our relationship with Christ, it's really all about one thing and one thing only, and it's about a relationship with Christ. It's good to have knowledge. It's good to be discerning. Jesus commends these guys for that. It's good to be working and laboring. All those things are really good, but they're really pointless without the relationship that we're supposed to have with Jesus. You know what? Turn over to 1 John real quick. 1 John, I'm going to have to find it here. I think it's in it's in chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. I just want to show you something. This is written by the same guy. Obviously, John's quoting Jesus in Revelation, but in this path, in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 12, it says this: I write to you little children because you are forgiven, or because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you fathers because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you young men because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you little children because you have known the Father. I have written to you fathers because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you young men because you are strong and the word of God abides in you and you have overcome the wicked one. That's a cool passage, but I just want to point something out to you. There are three spiritual states that John is talking about there. And he talks about children, and he talks about young men, and then he talks about fathers. And that corresponds to your walk with God. When you first become a believer, you are a brephos. It's a young child. It's the idea of young in the Lord. And when you are first a believer, there are a couple of things that John points out here that you know. And the first one is in verse 12. I write to you little children because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. That's the first thing that we learn when we come to Christ, that what God has done is he's taken our sins and he's thrown them away. He doesn't remember them anymore. He buries them in the sea of forgetfulness. The Bible says he throws them as far as east is from west, and he doesn't remember them anymore. And the other thing that you see in this passage about the children, let me go down here. Fathers, young men. At the end of verse 13. I write to you little children because you have known the Father. That's the other thing that young believers know, that they've known the Father, that they have a relationship with God that they never had before, and now all of a sudden that they have it. So two things. My sins have been forgiven, and I know the Lord now. That's cool, right? Then look at what it says about young men. In verse 13, in the middle of the verse, it says, I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. One of the things that takes place after you come into a relationship with God is you start getting trained and you start paying attention to what the Bible has to say, and you start overcoming the wicked one. You start having victory in your life. You start actually applying what the Bible teaches about the situations that you're going through, and you start winning. And you begin to overcome the wicked one. The other thing that you see about the young men in verse 14 is, again in the middle, it says, I have written to you young men because you are strong and the word of God abides in you. That's another thing about being kind of a middle-aged believer, is that you start really paying attention to the word and you become strong and God's word begins to abide in you. Great stuff, huh? Watch what it says about the fathers. And the fathers is speaking about people who've been believers for a long period of time. They're older in the Lord. I write to you fathers because you have known him who is from the beginning. So the first thing it says about the fathers is that they know him who is from the beginning. That's the Lord, right? And then if you look in verse 14, again he says, I have written to you fathers because you have known him who is from the beginning. So to the fathers he says one thing twice. You've known him who is from the beginning. So it kind of comes full circle. When I first get saved, I know two things. My sins have been forgiven, and I know the Lord. And when I get older in the Lord, I start paying attention to the word. I start paying attention to victory. I start doing the things that the Bible has to say, and I can focus in on that. But when I get older, you know what the thing is that really matters? Is that I know the Lord. And there's that whole situation with the love relationship with Christ, and that's what it's supposed to be about. And so what you have in the church at Ephesus is a situation where they're emphasizing basically the young man stage. I know the word, I overcome, I win in certain situations, and they're not emphasizing the fact that they know the Lord and that they're following him. And so what Jesus says to those guys is, you have left your first love. I want you to notice that he doesn't say, you lost your first love. Your first love is not something that you lose. Your first love is something that you leave. You leave. You get up and walk away from it. And that can be a situation that doesn't happen on purpose. It's kind of one of those things where you just get deflected. You just get your attention off the goal, off the main situation. You know, I went to Hawaii for vacation. I told you that last week. And one of the things that my kids did for me was they bought me a chance to go out skeet shooting. And so there was this place where you could go and you could, you know, it was a shooting range, and they had an instructor there. And I've been shooting for a long time. I've got friends who take me hunting and that kind of thing. And this was obviously shooting with shotguns. That's what you shoot skeet with. And one of the things that the instructor said was he was kind of being a little gentle with us about stuff. And I just told him, you know what? Anything that you've got to tell me, I want to listen to. Because, you know, basically, I'm just one of those guys. I want to get better at whatever I'm doing. And so there were a couple of things that he pointed out to me. And one of the things was that I track the targets really well. And so when the clay pigeon would take off, what's supposed to happen is you keep your eyes on the target. Keep your eyes on the target. Until, he said, I pick up my weapon. And so what you have is you have your shotgun right here, and the target starts going across your field of vision, and you're watching it. And he said, as soon as I would pick up my gun, I would take my eyes off the target and get it on the little, there's a little pointer thing at the end of your gun. And he said, I can see you doing this. You take your eyes off the target, you put it on the little pointer thing on the sight, basically, and then you have to reacquire the target. And so basically, I'm going like this, and the target's going across, and I'm looking at the target. As soon as I pull up my gun, now I'm looking at my gun. And my eyes get off the target, my gun does this, it wobbles around, and then I reacquire the target, and then I would hit it. And he said, don't do that. You keep your eye on the target, you leave it there, and you bring the gun up to the target, and as soon as you do, you squeeze the trigger. And you know what? Every stinking time I did that, it was like, bam, and I just blow the pigeon out of the sky. It was awesome. You keep your eyes on the target. And so what's the target with us? And the Bible talks about the fact that Jesus Christ is the author and the finisher of our faith. And what we're supposed to be doing is keep our eyes on him. And all the other stuff is really good. You know, we pay attention to doctrine. We pay attention to truth. We pay attention to the fact that not everybody who says that they're a Christian is going to tell you the truth. We pay attention to all that stuff. We make sure that we hang in there with the Lord. But the target is the Lord. It's him. And we keep our eyes on him. Here's another thing that happens with me. I'm a guy, and so I've taken those ADD tests, ADHD tests, and I think I have it. I don't really believe that, but anyway, one of the things that will happen is I'll be sitting there talking to my friends, and we're talking about some subject, and something in the background gets my attention, and I just start talking about that, and everybody in the conversation just kind of looks up and looks at me like I'm weird and stuff, and I get distracted all the time. And that's one of those things that can happen in your relationship with God. You can get distracted. Remember the story of Mary and Martha? Jesus goes over to their house, he's going over for dinner. And the Bible says that Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet, and she was hearing from the Lord. She was just spending time with Jesus. And Martha, the Bible says, was in the kitchen, and she was getting irritated because dinner's got to get made, and Mary's sitting in there just yakking with Jesus. And what she does is she comes in, and she says to Jesus, Jesus, make my sister come in and help me serve. And Jesus says, Martha, Martha, you are cumbered about with many things. I learned in the King James Version. You're busy about many things. But Mary has chosen that better part, and it will not be taken from her. And so a lot of times we can get so focused on serving and doing stuff that we're not paying attention to our relationship with Christ. And basically, we get distracted and we start moving off. And then you end up leaving your first love. There's nothing that's more important than Jesus. There's nothing that's more important to you and to him than that first love that you have for him. Look at verse 5. He says, remember, therefore, from where you... We're back in Revelation 2. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. And so Jesus gives a threefold formula for getting back into that relationship that you're supposed to be having with God. And the first thing that he says is, you need to remember from where you've fallen. Do you remember when you first gave your life to Jesus? Do you remember what it was like? Do you remember the first time you picked up your Bible and you started reading it? And the fact that when you were going through it, it was like God was speaking straight to you. Do you remember that when every time you went to church, it was like God had a word for you? You remember that? Remember what it was like to realize for the very first time that your sins were forgiven and that they were taken away. Remember the first time that you really realized that Jesus was in love with you, madly in love with you. The Bible talks about the fact that God's thoughts towards you are more than anyone can number. They're more than anyone can number. When I first heard that stuff, I was just blown away that there would be anybody who would think of me on that kind of level. And one of the things that impressed me the most about the Lord was that he knew me, he knew everything about me, and yet he loved me. And that's your first love. It's like you're just in love with Jesus and you want to go out and follow him. I talked about this probably about a month ago. When I first got saved, I was so excited. I was so excited. One of the first things that I did was I went out the next week. We had a swap meet. And I went out to the swap meet looking for crosses. Because, you know, I'm a Christian now, and I figure those Christians wear those cross things. And so I went out looking for a cross. And so I went to the swap meet and found this little beaded cross. You know, it had all these little beads on it. It was a leather thing, and then it had a little clay cross on it. And I stuck that on my neck, and I wore it around. I was so excited about that. I had that for years and years, wore it, just because I was in love with Jesus and I wanted everybody to know. I went out and got me a bumper sticker. And actually, it wasn't a bumper sticker. It was a window sticker. And I stuck it on the back of my 68 Charger, and it said, Jesus Christ is Lord. Left that puppy in there, and I wanted everybody to know who Jesus was in my life and the fact that I was serving and following him. I was not ashamed of the Lord, and I was in love with him because of the things that he'd done for me. And what you don't want to do ever is move away from that. You don't want to move away from that. How can you tell if you've moved away from that? Jesus talked about the fact that we need to be abiding in him, right? And abiding just means rooted and grounded. I need to be rooted and grounded in Christ, not moving. I got trees behind me here. They abide. They're rooted in the ground. They don't pack it up and move anytime, you know, that they're uncomfortable with where they're at. And there's going to be times when in your relationship with God, it's not convenient to be a Christian anymore. And you don't pack it up and move. You abide in Christ. You stay with him. And if you do that, then, you know, good things are going to happen. It's when, again, we can get distracted and we leave our first love. So how do you know if you've left your first love? Jesus said, if you love me, do what I say. If you love me, do what I say. And I don't want to make a works trip on you, but I can tell when I'm in love with Jesus. I am willing to do the things that Jesus says, no matter what they are. I'm willing to do it. And if I am unwilling to do the things that Jesus says about anything, then there's an issue. There's an issue. And so, you know, there are times when people will say, well, you know, they're not walking with the Lord, and they're doing this, and they're doing that, and all this stuff is going on, but they still love Jesus. You know what my answer to that is? No, they don't. There's something that they love more than Jesus. If they're doing the things that Jesus doesn't want them to do, and they're not willing to change the whole thing, then that thing that Jesus does not want them to do is a thing that they love more than they love the Lord. And so they may love him on some level, but not the level that God called us to. If you love me, Jesus said, do what I say. Keep my commandments. And so we have to be watching out for that. So you remember from where you've fallen. There's a passage in Jeremiah 2:2. Where God is speaking to the city of Jerusalem and talking about the relationship that they used to have with him. And he says this, thus says the Lord, I remember you, the kindness of your youth, the love of your betrothal, and when you went after me in the wilderness in a land not sown. You know, if you don't remember it, God does. He remembers what it was like when you were first in love with him. And so it would be a good thing to get back to that. Remember from where you've fallen. And then he says, repent. repent. And the word repent in Greek means turn around. And it's literally something that you do in your mind first, but you turn around, you stop going the direction that you're going, and you start moving the opposite direction. And so repentance means a change of direction, first in your thoughts and then in your life. And so the direction in this case of these people has been a loveless relationship with God. And what God says is turn that around, start out in your head, turn that around, and start going the opposite direction. And again, the way that you do that is by remembering what you've lost. And then finally, it talks about repeating. He says in the passage, repent and do the first works. Repent and do the first works. So it's remember, repent, and then repeat. So what were the first works? What were the first things that you did when you gave your life to the Lord? What were they? And some of those things were prayer, in my case. I didn't really know how to pray a whole lot, but I began trying to make that happen in my life because people told me that I needed to be talking to God. And so prayer is a big issue. And so I began speaking to the Lord. And so if you've had a prayerless walk for a while, it's something that you need to be looking at. Are you spending time with the Lord? You know what? You become like people who you hang out with. That's just the way that it goes. You can tell who you hang out with, and you can tell by the fact that you talk like them, you act like them, and you know it just goes that way. You become like who you hang out with. And so have you been hanging out with Jesus? And if you hang out with him, you're going to become more and more like him. And so you need to repeat. Do the first works. Read your Bible. And once again, when I first got saved, when I got saved, I've never read a Bible. I didn't even know what was in it. There were a couple of verses that I had heard about and stuff that had been thrown around. But for the most part, when I opened this black book, it was a black book to me. And every single word was stuff that I had never read before. And so when I would go through and read my Bible, it was like God was speaking to me out of every single verse. It was awesome. And you know what? It continues to be that way with me. I pick up my Bible, and when I read it, I'm not just reading a book that I learned about in Sunday school, because that never happened in my life. I'm reading a book that the first time I ever picked it up, God began talking to me about how I was supposed to deal with things, how I was supposed to talk about things, how my life was supposed to go. And God spoke to me out of every word. It's still like that with me. That's the way that I treat it. And part of the reason for that is because of this passage right here. And so the Word of God was something that you all of a sudden got a thirst for and you started going to. And obviously then there was an excitement that you had about Christ. And one of the things that happened with me again was I stand up here and I teach and I understand that it looks like I'm an out front kind of guy, but that's not usually the case. If you get me in a room full of people, generally I'm going to be the quiet guy sitting over on the side, or I'll be pushing my wife out in front because she's a great representative. If Bobby and Steve are there, if Bobby's doing all the talking, we're a great couple. If Steve's doing all the talking, it's like, boy, he doesn't talk very much, does he? You know, and that kind of thing. And so that's kind of how I'm built. But when I got saved, one of the things that happened in my life was I was so excited about the Lord that I would tell anybody. And it's not that I wasn't shy about it or I wasn't scared about it at times, because I was. But I couldn't keep my mouth shut. And so those are some of the things that I first did when I first got saved. Is that happening with you? Are you so in love with the Lord that you can't keep your mouth shut? And again, it's stuff that we need to be looking at and paying attention to. Verse 6, he says, but this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Now, this is another one of those things where Jesus is commending these guys. And there were a group of people, obviously called the Nicolaitans. They're mentioned twice in Revelation chapter 2, that Jesus did not really appreciate what they were teaching. We don't know exactly what these guys were doing. Because we don't know exactly what's going on. There are, as far as church history and stuff goes, there are passages in some of the church fathers where they talk about the Nicolaitans, and some of them taught that these guys were a Gnostic sect. And Gnostics were these guys who thought that they had deep knowledge that nobody else had. And so some of the church fathers believed that they were a Gnostic sect that held that God was not the creator of the world, and that it was acceptable to join in pagan worship, and that they encouraged idol worship, and they encouraged sleeping around with women. And so that's a possibility, because some of the stuff that the Gnostics taught and did had to do with that kind of thing. They believed that the Nicolaitans came from a guy named Nicholas. And in the book of Acts, there's a group of deacons that are the first ones that are appointed in the church to serve. And Nicholas was one of them. And the tradition is that Nicholas turned away and walked away from the Lord and began teaching all this false doctrine. And so that's a possibility. Another group of people go through and they just kind of take the word apart itself. Nicolaitans comes from two words in Greek. Nikao, actually Nike. Some of you guys have Nikes on. And Nike means victory or to overcome. And it's Nikao and Laos. And Laos is a word that means the people. And so Nicholas or Nicolaitan literally means the overcomers of the people. There are these doctrines that run through the church pretty routinely, and they usually have like a 10-year cycle, and one of them is called shepherding. When I was a kid in high school, I was a kid in high school, when I first got saved, one of the doctrines that went around was the shepherding doctrine, and it was a big fat deal. There were a lot of people who were into it, and it went like this. You are led to the Lord by somebody, and when you become a Christian, they become your shepherd. And that person has basically control over your life. All the stuff that you are doing in your life needs to go through that guy. In other words, if I want to get married, if I want to go to school, if I want to spend my money on certain things, then I need to go and talk to my shepherd and find out if I should do those things. And he had the yay or nay vote on everything that I did. He was my shepherd. And that guy had a shepherd who was over him. Same kind of deal, and another shepherd who was over him, and that kind of stuff. And that was a big, fat deal. And obviously, there's a whole level of control there that the Bible doesn't even talk about. Now, the Bible does talk about submission to ruling authorities and submission even to pastors and that kind of thing, but never on that kind of level. Never on that kind of level. I don't have time to shepherd your life. I don't have time for that. I have enough problems with my own life taking care of me and what I should be spending my money on and not spending my money on and what I should be doing and what I shouldn't be doing and that kind of stuff. And I don't mind talking to people and letting them know what the Bible has to say about stuff, but I don't want to run your life. I'm not interested. And so you have that. One of the modern movements that's gone back to the shepherding movement is the G12 movement. And you may have heard of that. And it's a kind of thing where, again, it's like a pyramid type thing, where you have a certain amount of people who are under you, in this case 12, and those 12 people need to be reporting to you, and they need to get 12 people on their own, and that kind of stuff. And you know, in both those situations, whether you're talking about shepherding or whether you're talking about G12, it would kind of be cool to be on the top, right? So you're shepherding everybody else, and they're not shepherding you. And the Bible, again, does not teach that. The Bible says that if you want to be great in God's kingdom, that you need to be the servant, not the overlord. You need to be the servant of all. And so when you're talking about your walk with Christ, one of the things that needs to be seen in your walk with Christ is the fact that you are willing to serve and not just run people. And so, you have that whole thing. Now, again, like I said, we don't know exactly from history or even from the Bible what the Nicolaitans were teaching. Those were just two things that I threw out to you that most commentators talk about. But we do know this, that the deeds of the Nicolaitans are things that Jesus hates. And what Jesus said was, "This you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate." So I don't know exactly what these guys were doing, but I can go through my Bible and I can look up verses that talk about what God hates, right? And so let's just do that real quick. I went through and took out a number of verses, and they're all in the Old Testament that speak about the things that God hates. Here's one, Deuteronomy 16:22. It says, "You shall not set up a sacred pillar which the Lord your God hates." And basically that has to do with idolatry. A sacred pillar was a pole that represented male parts. That's what they were, just to be blunt with you. And God hates that. And you see that in a number of places in ancient Rome. Actually, have you guys watched the movie The Gladiator? In the movie The Gladiator, you have to watch it on TV because it's rated R in the regular movie. But in the movie The Gladiator, they have this whole thing in the Colosseum. And in the Colosseum, they have some fights and stuff. And what you'll see is a couple of different poles on two ends of the Colosseum. And those were sacred pillars. And that's what they represented, male parts. A lot of paganism was highly sexual, and it was out of line as far as what the Lord had to say. Psalm 5:5 talks about the boastful. The boastful shall not stand in your sight. You hate all workers of iniquity. And so God hates boastfulness. In Psalm 11, verse 5, it says, the Lord tests the righteous, but the wicked, the one who loves violence, his soul hates. And so somebody who loves violence is something that God hates. Psalm 45, verse 7, it says, you love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. And so wickedness is something that God hates. Proverbs 6, 16 through 19 says, there are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a man who stirs up dissension among brothers. So those are things that God hates. In Psalm 97, verse 10, it says this: you who love the Lord hate evil. He preserves the soul of his saints. He delivers them out of the hand of the wicked. And in Proverbs 8:13, it says, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogance in the evil way and the perverse mouth, I hate. And so one of the things that we're supposed to be known for is hating the things that God hates. We have to be in agreement with the Lord. And so God goes through and he lists things that he hates. And in this case, it's the deeds of the Nicolaitans. But I just gave you a whole bunch of other stuff that God hates too. And if that stuff's in your life, God hates it. And so it needs to be gone. And if you're seeing that in other people's lives, God hates it. It doesn't mean that you have to hate the person, but you don't get involved with it, right? And so obviously, idolatry. What's idolatry? Putting anything before the Lord. That's idolatry. That's what it is. And so people who will put things before the Lord and basically put God on second or third or fourth or fifth level. I don't want to be involved with that kind of thing. Boastfulness, you know, it's like you always have guys who are tooting their own horn and that kind of stuff and promoting themselves. Obviously, we don't want to be involved with that. People who love violence, those are pretty straightforward. And the rest of the list is pretty straightforward. And so obviously, we're supposed to love what God loves. We're supposed to hate what God hates. And if we don't do that, we set ourselves up against the Lord. Verse 7, he says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And that's one of those things that obviously we want. We want to have the blessings of God. We want to have access to the tree of life. Over in Revelation chapter 22, you have the tree of life described as being given back to the people of God. And it's in the new heaven and the new earth. And in verse 1, it says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and in the midst of its street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And so when the tree of life is restored to us, it's something that literally in Greek says it's going to be for the health of the nations. Does that mean that we're going to be sick and need healing in the new heaven and new earth? I don't think so. I think what it's doing is it's a preservative. And one of the things that you see with the tree of life in the book of Genesis is that God says that he needed to drive the man and the woman out when they committed their sin from the garden, lest they eat from the tree of life and live forever. And so it looks like it was the tree of life that gave this preservative type of situation to people. And God didn't want these people staying in their sin. He had other plans for them. But when God comes back takes you home to be with him, he makes a promise here that you're going to partake of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Apparently 12 fruits, one for each month. That's interesting, because in the new heaven and new earth, apparently you have months, right? And so one for each month. And so it's a tree that bears 12 different kinds of fruits. That's pretty cool. Then in verse 8, back in chapter 2, you have the persecuted church. And it says, "And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things, says the first and the last who was dead and came to life." Now, the church at Smyrna had a history. And one of the things that you have with the church of Smyrna is that these guys were really into emperor worship. And one of the things that Christians were commanded to do in the early centuries was to take a pinch of incense, and at the very beginning, they would bring these tables into a town. You had to take a pinch of incense, and you had to put it on a plate, and you had to burn that to the genius of Rome, basically. It's the idea of the Roman spirit. And it was a worship of the spirit that was behind Rome. So it was kind of supposed to be a patriotic thing, but they couched it in pagan stuff. And so you were literally worshiping Rome. Later on, they started bringing in Roman Caesars. And so they would bring in a bust of a Roman Caesar, somebody who has died. And not only would you be giving incense to Rome itself, but to the Caesars of Rome. And then by the time that we get to the book of Revelation, Domitian, the emperor who was alive at this time, demanded that they actually worship him as God. And so when you see the phrase "Caesar is Lord" in the Bible, that was a direct attack on Jesus's deity. And when you see the phrase "Jesus is Lord," that was a direct answer to the whole idea of emperor worship. And Smyrna was one of those towns that was known for that. All the Christians had to do was burn that pinch of incense, say "Caesar is Lord," and they would receive a certificate that said that they had basically worshiped the emperor, and then they could go away and worship as they pleased. But that is something that Christians would not do. And so in Smyrna, there was a general persecution of Christians because Smyrna was into that, and the Christians wouldn't do it. Okay? By the way, the name Smyrna itself, it comes from the word myrrh. And myrrh was an embalming element. It was a spice that was crushed to bring out its sweetness, but it was an embalming element. And in the same way, many times Christians over the years have been crushed, and what it's supposed to do is bring out your sweetness. It goes in this passage and it says, "These things says the first and the last who was dead and came to life." And that's the title of Christ in that passage. Now, one of the things that Jesus does in each one of these letters is he gives a title that's appropriate to the church. And basically, it's interesting that he uses the title, "the first and the last, and the one who was dead and came to life." If you're the first and the last, you're the only one who counts. And that's the point that Jesus is making to a church that's under persecution. You know what? Jesus never promised that when you became a Christian that everything was going to be rosy and it was all going to go the way that you think it should go. What Jesus promised was that in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." Jesus never said that the Christian life was going to be something that was going to be problem-free and, you know, that you were just going to go through your life and everything was going to be great. He never said that. And sometimes people walk away from the Lord because they didn't sign up for this deal. They thought the deal was, I'm going to get saved and everything's going to be awesome, and then I'm going to go to heaven and everything's going to be awesome, and that's all that there was going to be. And the first time that they have any kind of trial or problem in their life, especially from the people who are around them, they pack it up, they bag it, and they walk away. Jesus talked about people like that in the parable of the sower. He said, some of the seed that gets sown of the word of God falls on rocky ground. And what happens is it grows up, but because it's growing up in rocks, it has no roots. And when the sun comes out, it withers it. And he said, there are people who are going to come and follow me who will for joy begin following me, But in time of persecution or time of trouble, they'll walk away. And it's because they have no root in themselves. And so Jesus needs to be the one who matters to you. Jesus talked about the fact that people were going to attack you and persecute you. It's in Matthew chapter 10. But what God said was, if you're going to be afraid of somebody, don't be afraid of somebody who can destroy your body. But instead, be afraid of somebody who can cast both body and soul into hell. And basically what the Lord was doing there was he's saying, you know what, you're going to be afraid of somebody, and if that's going to be your motivation, then you need to be afraid of the guy you need to be afraid of, which is the Lord. But then he immediately goes on and talks about the fact that God loves you. And he goes, a sparrow that falls to the ground doesn't do that without God knowing all about it. And you are of much more value than many sparrows. And so God loves you. So instead of being motivated by fear, you need to be motivated by the love of God. And this is the way that it works. I'm standing in front of somebody. They're doing something to me. They're saying something to me. They're making me feel afraid. And at that point, if I'm about to cave in my relationship with God, instead of being afraid of that person, I need to be more God-fearing than man-fearing. If I seek to please men, then I'm no longer the servant of Christ. I'm to fear God and him before anybody else. And if you fear God, there's all kinds of places that you will not go. That's very cool. But even more than that, I need to be motivated by my relationship with God and by the fact that he loves me. Why would I ever leave Jesus? Why would I ever cave on the things that Jesus calls me to? Why would I ever do that? Jesus has been faithful to me for my whole life. He's been by my side no matter what. Why would I ever turn away from him? He's the first and he's the last. Get it? Isn't that cool? And then he says, the one who was dead and came to life. Basically, what he's saying in that section is, when these guys were getting persecuted, what was going to happen to them was they were going to kill them. It wasn't, you know, saying things like, oh, you're just a Jesus freak. Oh, no, I'm a Jesus freak. They're calling me names and, you know, having people walk away. It's literally, you're a Christian. We're going to kill you if you don't worship Caesar. We're a Christian, we're going to kill you if you don't deny Christ. That's the situation that they were in. And Jesus reminds them that he's not only the first and the last, but he was the one who was dead and came to life. And that's the same thing with you. You're all gonna die unless Jesus comes back first. You're all gonna die. And when people die, it's a real scary thing. And again, I get to deal with that a lot just because I'm a pastor. It's a real scary thing. But you don't have to fear death, because we know the one who was dead and came back to life, right? And he says, I know your works, tribulation, and poverty, but you are rich. And I know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. This was a poor church. And again, the reason that they were poor was because they were under persecution. When you were a Christian in the early church, many times what would happen is, if they found out that you were a Christian, you would lose your job. If they found out you were a Christian, they would take your land. If they found out you were a Christian, you couldn't get a job. And that was the situation with these guys. And so there was a real poverty in this church because of the persecution that was taking place. But Jesus goes, I see your poverty, but you're rich. Because there are times when you're going to be giving up things for the Lord because of the things that people are doing around you. And again, in this case, it was persecution. But Jesus sees all that, and he rewards you for it. He's faithful in the midst of those kinds of things. And again, you need to keep those in mind. He says, I know the blasphemy. Oh, by the way, this church was poor financially, but God said that they were rich. There's another church later on, Laodicea, that's rich financially, and he says, you're poor. And I would rather be poor financially and rich in the face of God than rich financially and poor in the sight of God. And again, we need to have a straight head about those things. It talks here about the fact that they were under tribulation, and he's talked about, I know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. And in that instance, what was happening in the early church many times was that there were literally Jews who were opposed to Jesus that would turn the Christians in. And Jesus is saying, I see that. I know that. I know what's going on there. I see what's happening. They have my name on them in the sense of they're supposed to be my people, but they're not my people. There's a passage in John chapter 8 where Jesus was talking to the Jews and he let them know that they were of their father, the devil. He said, basically, you do the devil's works. You're of your father, the devil. And Jesus is saying the same thing in this passage, that these guys are not of God. They're the synagogue of Satan. He says, do not, verse 10, this is the exhortation, do not fear any of these things which are about to, which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful until death and I'll give you the crown of life. I want you to notice that he doesn't promise to deliver them from the trial. Be faithful unto death and I'll give you the crown of life. A lot of times we think that when we go through trials that what God should do is deliver us through it. Sometimes God does that, and that's a very cool thing. But most times what God does is he just walks through the trial with you. And there are trials that you're going to go through no matter what. There's stuff that's going to happen to you no matter what. You live in a fallen world, in a fallen body with fallen people. And all of that stuff's going to affect you on some in some way or another. And you know what? It was going to affect you whether you became a Christian or not. But what God promises is that he's going to walk with you through those trials. Now, here's one of the things about the persecuted church, and it was actually a pretty cool thing. From about the mid-first century all the way up until the 300s, the church was under persecution. And you know what that meant? It meant that everybody in the building, everybody at the church was a committed believer, unless they were somebody that was trying to infiltrate. Every single one of them loved Jesus and was going to go for it. And because of that, the most powerful age in all of church history was the second and the third centuries. Awesome things were going on with the church, and literally, they were covering the Roman Empire with the message of the gospel. You know why? Because when persecution is taking place, every once in a while, what God does is he shakes people up. And when persecution is taking place, all the people who are flaky, all the people who are not committed, all the people who are fake, don't really want to follow Jesus, they're not going to be involved. They're going to walk away from these things. And what you've got left is absolutely committed believers who are going to do the things that Jesus wants them to do. They are gold at that point. And what the church was in the early centuries was a lean, mean preaching machine. It's good when that happens. The church in China, lean, mean preaching machine. The church in Russia, when the Russians were persecuting Christians, lean, mean preaching machine. The church in Africa, right at this point, especially in northern Africa, where the Muslims are coming in and literally taking Christians and crucifying them on their doors. A lean, mean preaching machine. People who love Jesus and will follow him no matter what. And that's what was happening in the church at Smyrna. It would be good if we were that too, huh? And in this passage, it goes on here and says, do not fear those things which you're about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested and you will have tribulation 10 days. And there's a lot of speculation on what the 10 days means. It probably, just in the context of these guys, means you're going to go under persecution for a short period of time. But it's very interesting that there were 10 specific persecutions of the church in the Roman Empire. The first one was under Nero. The second one was under Domitian, who was the emperor at this point. Then Trajan, Hadrian, Severus, Maximin, Decius, Valerian, Aurelian, Diocletian. There's literally 10 persecutions of the church under the Roman Empire. And so that may be part of what Jesus was talking about. In any case, he says, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. You think you could die for Jesus? I've always wondered that, if I could do it. You know, I read a book, and it's a book worth reading. It's called Fox's Book of Martyrs. And you go through and you read the things that these guys went through. And when I would read it, I would just be like, God, I don't know if I can do that. I don't know if that can happen. Because some of these guys were literally cut in pieces. Some of these guys literally had their intestines pulled out of them. Some of these guys obviously burnt alive. They were burnt alive. And all the stuff, sometimes they were what was called flayed. It was where they would peel your skin off of you, trying to get you to deny Christ. And I would read these testimonies of these guys who died for Jesus, and I was like, Lord, I don't know if I could do that. I don't know if I wouldn't cave. But you know what's cool about God? God empowers you to do the things that he calls you to. So I'm not a person who thinks that I could go and die for Jesus. I don't think that I could do that in my own flesh. But I do know that if I was put in that situation, that God would give me the power of the Spirit, and he would help me to get through that. And it's the same thing with you. There are those times when you're going to stand up for the Lord, and you know that it's going to cost you something. And what God's going to do is he's going to empower you to get through the whole thing. He's going to give you the power to do that. Verse 11, he says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death. Second death is mentioned in Revelation in chapter 19, and it talks about the first death being physical death, the second death being the lake of fire. Hell is the second death. And so the rule goes like this in the Bible. Jesus talked about the fact that we need to be born again. We were born physically once, and then we need to be born spiritually. And the Bible talks about not only being born twice, it talks about dying twice. I am born physically, and then I need to be born spiritually too. I need to have a relationship with God. And I'm going to die physically, but I can die spiritually too and be separated from God forever. And that's the lake of fire. And this is the rule in the Bible. If you're born once, if you're only born physically, you're going to die twice. You're going to die physically, and then the second death is going to be the lake of fire. It's going to be hell. But if you're born twice, if you're born both physically and spiritually, born again, then you're only going to die once. And that death is just physical death. And that might as well just be a door going into heaven, because that's all it is. It ends up being this barrier that God takes down, and you walk right into the presence of God. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that's what Christians are looking forward to. Born once, die twice. Born twice, die once. And obviously we want to be the people who are born twice. And we're going to stop right there and do communion. And obviously, in all these things that we've been talking about, it fits in with communion right well. There's a passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that talks about the fact that we need to be having a right relationship with Jesus. In the passage it says, therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. And for this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. Remember I was talking about the fear of God? This is one of those passages that enjoins that whole thing. You know, God does not let you just get away with stuff. And so there needs to be a right relationship with him. And so whenever we're partaking of communion, it's something where we need to be examining ourselves. And obviously, you are not perfect. I am not perfect. Nobody on the planet is perfect except for Jesus. But there is a right relationship with God where you know him and you love him and you're following after him and you're making things right with the people who are around you as much as you can. That's what's supposed to be happening. And if that's not going on, then you could be sitting there playing a game and pretending that you're something that you're not. And God sees all of that. He sees it. And it needs to be taken care of. So he says, you're to do this in a worthy manner. And this is why. It says in verse 23, I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. The reason that communion is so important, and it's so important to make sure that your walk is right with the Lord before you partake of it, is because it represents Jesus and it represents the things that Jesus did. And so it's one of those things where every time that we take communion, we're supposed to be going through and examining ourselves. How are you doing with the Lord? Do you have a real walk with Him? What's going on there? And, you know, getting the thing right just takes repentance. It's all it takes is repentance. And you don't have to stand up and do this big old huge thing. You just have to, in your heart, go before the Lord and go, God, you know, I've been wrong. I haven't been doing the things that I'm supposed to be doing. And God, I want things to be right between you and me. And so, Lord, will you please forgive me? And so every time you partake of communion, it's stuff that where you need to be examining yourself. And if there are things that are wrong, then you just take care of them. And if there's nothing wrong, then praise the Lord. That's cool. God's been doing cool things in your life. And so, again, when we partake of communion, we examine ourselves, make sure that we're right with the Lord. Right? Okay. And so we're going to pass out communion, and we're going to take it together. Just hold the elements, and we'll pray over them, and then we'll partake of them.